Everyone, a very good evening to my seniors and my dear friends. Good morning to Shravan sir, and good evening to our beloved speaker Dr. Manjula Reddy garu and AN garu. Myself Madhu Gundagane, pursuing first year food technology. I'm honored to be as a host for this marvelous session. Now let us start our session with the invocation and gratitude story. Now I would like Shravya to tell invocation.
Thank you, Madhu. Good evening, everyone. Powerful we are, compassionate we are, genius we are, adventurous we are, disruptive we are, distinctive we are, beautiful we are, revolutionaries we are, empathetic we are, courageous we are, grateful we are, attentive we are, learners we are, insentiment we are, rebellious we are, heartful we are, inspiring we are, leaders we are, genius we are, champion we are, yes, powerful we are. Thank you.
Thank you, Shravya. Now let us hear a gratitude story by Shravanti.
Thank you, Madhu. Good evening, everyone. Let me share a gratitude story with you. Those are my preteen days. My mom used to have a Nokia phone. It is only capable of listening radio and text messaging. So I have only two options, either to text anyone or listen to the radio. I don't know how to do text messaging, and my friends too. So I have only one option, and that is listening to radio. I was addicted to radio and listening to it after my school. A few days later, we were busy with a new electronic device, which is called television. It is one of my favorite habits. I used to watch movies, reality shows, and interviews, etc. Me and my sister used to involve in those characters, like she used to act as an anchor and I as an interviewer, or sometimes vice versa. I never anticipated that those memories will come to real. Yes, I spoke in a radio interview, and that too with a famous country, America. How could I express my happiness? My mom and dad felt very happy that I am doing such great things and speaking better English than before. My mom showered her happiness towards me, but dad's happiness I have seen in his eyes. I'm very happy that those smiles are because of me. I would never get those smiles if Michelle ma'am didn't spend her time on me. How could I express my gratitude to that annoying relationship? This is a small heartfelt write-up by me to express my gratitude towards ma'am. Thank you. By Tejasri Akka. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Shravanti. It's a wonderful story. Thank you for reading it out. Now, let me introduce our today's top speaker, Dr. Manjula Reddy garu. She is an Indian bacterial geneticist. She is the chief scientist at the Center for Cellular and Molecular Biology in Hyderabad, India. In 2019, she won the Infosys Prize in Life Sciences for her work on bacterial cell wall structure and synthesis. She is a fellow of the Telangana Academy of Sciences and the Indian Academy of Sciences. She has earned her PhD from the Center of Cellular and Molecular Biology in 2002. She has started her lab at the institution in 2007. She is also an editorial board member of Journals of Bacteriology. Now let us hear about her work and research from our dear and dear Dr. Manjula Reddy garu. It's over to you, ma'am.
Yeah. Thank you. And thanks to all of you for having me here. I think it's an honor to be here with these youngsters. So I didn't have too much of background knowledge of what this top cell would be. So what I intend to do today is first speak about my research really very briefly, because it involves a lot of intense molecular biology and genetics, right? Then I will kind of little bit tell you about my life story. I hope you won't get bored with it. And in the end, you know, we can just discuss, we can be more interactive, right? And I see a lot of girls here. I went through all the names of all the people who are here. See that most of you are actually doing BTech in different years of college. And I think mostly people are from chemical engineering background, right? Some of them in food technology, and some of them I think are in textile engineering, right? And I am not sure how much of biology you have studied, right? I will completely make it very, very simple. Okay. If I go overboard, I actually want you to stop and then ask me. Okay. It's mostly an interactive thing. Okay. And let's talk about in general about life, about science, about passion, pursuit of happiness, all the things, right? This is not going to be a scientific lecture. Okay. Is that okay, Madhu?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Thanks, Madhu, for a good introduction. So this is where I work, and it's called Center for Cellular and Molecular Biology. And I have spent more than half of my life here, enjoyed my stay here, and then I still love doing what I do every day. Okay, so our founder director of this institute was Professor Bhargava, who started this in 1977, and he believed that the science, nature, and art go together. So we have a very beautiful institute with a lot of very good paintings, as you can see in the slide. And then also it has a lot of greenery, very rare trees, and etc. I think that you should all come and visit CCMB once. We have open day on September 26th. Anybody can walk in and then look at the institute and look at the science, what CCMB is doing, and people are there to explain on that day only. So I think I would be happy if you could visit on that day. Then this is a lab in CCMB, and this happens to be my lab. So you see three students here who are my PhD students. So they join for PhD after doing MSc in any of the life sciences, biology or even physics or chemistry. Graduates can join CCMB for doing their PhD. So this is a typical molecular biology laboratory. And what you see next is a microbiology laboratory where most of the microbial work dealing with bacteria is done. Okay. And this is my group. Most of them are PhD students, and some of them are, you see some senior people. They actually help in running the lab. Right. So, and then of course, all of us, what do we do here? Right. I said that something like 35 years of my life I spent here. Then what do I do is we all try to work to see how the bacteria grow. Okay. I'm going to tell you a little bit more background about bacteria. Right. So essentially, what are bacteria? Bacteria are microorganisms which are present everywhere on this earth. So when you say they are ubiquitous, they are present everywhere. Okay, so what did actually bacteria mean? Bacteria mean they are like small sticks. Why they have named bacteria is because when Antony Leeuwenhoek first described the microscope, he looked at bacteria under the microscope. And he saw small rods. So that is where he called them bacteria. And they are unicellular. So which means it's a single cell, right? And they all come in different shapes and sizes. You can see some of them here. Okay, now I have a laser pointer here. So you can see that bacteria come in all shapes and sizes. Either they are round or they are egg-shaped or rod-shaped or spiral or pretty long, spirals as you see here, right? And the what I said, the ubiquitous, they are present everywhere. They are present in deep oceans, coldest regions of the earth. And most importantly, they are present on human bodies. That's the place where bacteria live the most. So you can, this shows that if you have your own cells, something like 30 trillion cells, you have 100 trillion bacteria in you. They are present all over the skin, right? And most abundant is your gut, your teeth, right? Your oral cavities, everywhere bacteria are present. People think that if you weigh all of them, there would be something like 2 kgs of bacteria. All of you carry something like 2 kgs of bacteria in yourself, right? So that makes bacteria quite important to study, right? And again, you know that there are harmful bacteria and useful bacteria, right? Harmful bacteria, most of you know these very important diseases like tuberculosis and leprosy, right? Now, this picture shows some of the pathogenic bacteria. For example, now here you see Mycobacterium tuberculosis, which causes tuberculosis. Klebsiella causes pneumonia. Streptococcus causes lot of diseases, particularly they make lesions on the skin. Okay, I'm sure people would get, people call them hot lesions and all that. So they make some kind of wounds on the skin. Right, and then again, we all know about useful bacteria, right? And the most important ones are the ones which make yogurt, which make milk curdle, right? We eat them every day. And these are the bacteria which you eat every day, right? Because the curds has the most lactobacillus, lactococcus, bifidobacterium, and this thermophilus are the ones which we almost eat trillion bacteria in per day. I have also put E. coli, Escherichia coli here. This is not present in yogurt, but I have put this here because this bacteria is the one which is studied the most in the lab. And I happen to study this bacterium. It's called a model organism because it's very easy to study in the lab. Okay, So as I said, we use E. coli as our model organism. And if you look at E. coli under a scanning electron microscope, this is how it looks. It's a rod-shaped one. You remember you saw it in the earlier slide that the E. coli was seen like this. And all these white fibrous things are the something like they're called flagella, which help in E. coli to move from one location to the other so that they can, when they see the nutrients or food, then they move towards that side. Right? Now, remember I said that the bacteria live everywhere and they just have one single cell. But then remember, if they have to live at all places on Earth, they should have some kind of covering to the cell, right, which makes them resistant to all these conditions, very harsh conditions of the universe. For that, they do have a cell wall, right? So now the one which showed in this yellow color is the cell wall. Now, below the cell wall is something called you can almost see something like a gunny bag, right? This kind of structure is part of their cell wall. It is called peptidoglycan. So the peptidoglycan is present in all bacteria and it covers the cell and protects it from the extracellular harsh conditions. So it, as it's written here, it's a large sac-like molecule and it's a single molecule. It's a large molecule. I'm sure you all have studied chemistry in your 12th class, right? So you know what is a polymer, right? So it's a large polymer which covers the cell, okay? And then protects all the inner contents of the cell. Okay, so now what I am going to tell you is little bit about peptidoglycan, because this is exactly I study. I study the bacterial peptidoglycan. Okay, and now look, what you see here is a one single bacterium. So I'm basically going to talk to you about how a bacterial cell grows. Extremely simple. Look, we are multicellular, we have lot of cells, so our growth is very complex. But the bacterial growth is extremely simple. You see one small gray colored cell here, a small one. Whenever it sees food, right, it grows in size, just like us, right? Now you see this one, the growth has occurred. It almost became double in size. After it grows in double, right, then the cell exactly splits into half, right? And then it becomes two daughter cells are formed, which are exactly identical. And now if there are enough nutrients, now this cell again will become double, right? And then divide into two. That's how, when food is available, bacteria grow very rapidly and exponentially. Exponentially would mean that one will become two, two will become four, four will become eight, right? So that's the simple bacterial life cycle. Now, what I'm going to tell you is, now, if a bacteria has to grow, the bacterial cell wall also has to grow in size, right? And it also has to split into two to become these two individual daughter cells. And this is exactly what I study. I study how bacterial cell walls grow in length for them to elongate in size. Because if they don't elongate, if the inner contents are increasing in volume, right, the cell is going to burst and then it's going to die. So the bacterial cell wall growth is tightly coupled to the bacterial cell growth. And why is it important, right? Why do people want to study this bacterial cell growth? There are two reasons. One is people want to understand the nature's secrets, how bacteria grow, right? How do they divide? So this is called basic research. So that's one purpose why people study bacterial growth. And the other thing is, if you know the secrets of how bacteria grow, then you can effectively design molecules which inhibit this growth so that they will work as new antibiotics, right? And you know what antibiotics are. We all take them when we have bacterial infections, right? And here I have put two such antibiotics, very famous. All of you would have heard about penicillins. Vancomycins are somewhat rarely used. So penicillins are the antibiotics which inhibit bacterial cell wall growth. So the bacterial cell wall antibiotics are very popular because in humans, we don't have peptidoglycan. So they do not cause toxicity in the host, which means human beings or any animals which take those antibiotics. They only are able to inhibit the bacteria which are growing in us. So this slide again reflects how the bacterial cell walls grow. And if you remember, I actually said it's a large molecule. It's an elastic polymer and it's a large molecule, right? So I'm not really going into the chemical structure of the cell wall, but you can see that it is exactly like a gunny bag, right? It's a gunny bag covering the cytosol. Cytosol is the one which is present inside the bacteria. So now, as the cytosol is growing, the peptidoglycan has to grow. But I just said it is like a gunny bag. How can a gunny bag become bigger? You remember, gunny bag has all these pores which are interconnected by these mesh-like work. Peptidoglycan is exactly like that. But when you extend this gunny bag, the pores will also become big. And a cell cannot afford to do that because all the outside molecules will enter through the pores, right? So the cell has to devise a way in which their covering has to become big whenever the cytosolic contents are increasing. So then what we figured out here is, so we hypothesized, so all the research goes mostly by hypotheses, right? Initially you try to solve a problem, then you have a hypothesis, then you try to see whether your hypothesis is correct or not. So what we hypothesized was, if you want to make this bacterial cell wall grow bigger, you have to break the polymer in between, and then the polymer will, you know, then the space will come in the middle. In that space, new peptidoglycan material will come, and then again it will get re-stitched together. So now you see that initially there were three of these chains. Okay, so peptidoglycan means that it is made up of two components, glycan chains, okay, and which are connected to each other by short peptide chains. Okay, peptidoglycan would mean that. So now you can see that the peptide chains are connected with each other by these peptide bonds. Okay, now when these bonds are cut, they make space. Into this space, this you can see this new red glycan strand coming in together. And then there are enzymes which again resynthesize these bonds together, now which will integrate this red strand. So that's how now you can see it here, that it becomes bigger. Right? So what we had hypothesized is, now for all this to happen, you require some enzymes, right? You know that enzymes are proteins with a activity, right? Those that activity would be cleaving this peptide bond between these chains. So this scissors depict those enzymes. These are the cleavage enzymes which cut the peptidoglycan, right? And then the new synthesis would happen. So the enzymes which form these crosslinks are known from last 50 years. In fact, these enzymes are the ones which are targeted by penicillins. So penicillin, when you take all these penicillin derivatives, they inhibit the crosslink forming enzymes so that the peptidoglycan is not formed, and that is how the bacteria die when we take those antibiotics. Now, what we found was a step before this crosslink formation, and we found that there are enzymes which cut these bonds, and without these enzymes, again, bacterial cell will not be able to grow in length and it dies. So we kind of course, we use lot of different approaches to come to these. How did we identify these enzymes? I'm not going to go into the details, but this is where genetics and molecular biology comes into picture. So using those tools, we identified these four enzymes which cut different kinds of crosslinks which are present in peptidoglycan, and we named them as murine endopeptidases. Murine is another word for peptidoglycan. Murine means actually a wall, right? So in Latin, murus means wall. So here, of course, it's a bacterial cell wall. So this is what we were able to do in last 10 years or so. This, if any of you are from chemistry background, I thought that this is going to help. So as I said, this is the peptidoglycan, which forms like sac-like structure. So people call it sacculus. Okay, it's called PG sacculus. And then it is made up of these glycan strands, which are very simple sugars. So this is a sugar molecule, which is attached to another sugar, and they are repeated. These disaccharides are repeated. And now these glycan strands are connected to these peptides. Peptides are normally made of amino acids, right? So these amino acids are called alanine, glutamic acid, and these four amino acids make this peptide chain. This peptide chain is attached to one of the sugars again. So now everything is linked, right? So this is like, so if somebody asks you what is the largest molecule in bacteria, it is actually the peptidoglycan, because it is cross-linked with each other. Now what we figured out are the enzymes now which cut these black lines which you see. These are the peptide bonds. So those are the cross-links which are cleaved. when a peptidoglycan saculus needs to be enlarged. So I actually want to now give you a very, analogy with a very layman's terms. Now imagine a room, okay? Now a single room, don't imagine a room in a house, but you just imagine something like an outhouse. It is just standing by its own. And now you want to make that room bigger. Okay, how will you make that room bigger? You will break wall on one side, right? Say for example, on this side, you can make it bigger, right? Or you can break the other wall and then make it bigger. Or you can break both walls on the sides and then construct again more, longer wall, and then which you can join, right? But you know what bacteria does? Bacteria breaks the walls in the middle, right? Like it breaks all over in the place. Then the new bricks are put here. I hope you are seeing this, these blank spaces which are here. So it's exactly like now you have a room. The enzymes, the cleavage enzymes come, remove some bricks from that place, making space so that the new bricks are able to come. And then there are enzymes again, which put the cement in between the bricks and then glue them together. Right? This is exactly how the cell operates. Right? But then you need to remember now the room can be elongated only when you have excess or additional bricks and cement for it to elongate. The bricks and cement for the bacteria are the food molecules, right? The nutrients. So the bacteria will elongate only when it sees enough food, and then it now will grow. Right? I mean, you can imagine, you will basically start working on your room expansion only you have enough resources to buy the cement or bricks, right? It exactly does that. So which means that the cleavage enzymes, right, are like the workers. They come and then break the wall, right? But who tells them, now you should break the wall when there are enough nutrients, right? There you require somebody called like a supervisor, right? The supervisor tells the workers, now you go break the wall. And the supervisor actually knows that there are enough bricks and cement there. Then he tells the workers to clean. This is how exactly cells operate. There are again molecules, proteins, which sense the presence of nutrients, and these supervisor molecules relay the information to the worker proteins, which are cleavage enzymes, to break. So this is how cells operate, right? I mean, they're almost like, they're like machines, right? They know when to do what to do. So this is one very good example of how proteins sense their surroundings and then relay that information to other proteins so that the cells grow in their size. Right? So then so this slide shows, these are real bacteria which I use. So this is, so I said, remember, bacteria are very small. You can't see them. They're something like 1 to 2 micron in size. So you can't see them unless you use a microscope. And these are seen by a microscope called scanning electron microscope. So now you see that what you see here, this rod-shaped one, is something like 2 micron. Okay. Now, remember I said that the cleavage, hydrolase, the enzymes are important for growth. Now we have, using the genetic techniques, what we do is slowly remove the enzymes which are required for the cutting the peptidoglycan. So you slowly remove. As you remove, they become this oval shape. And look at this, slowly they start dying so badly. in the end, all their cell contents have leaked out and then they completely die. So what this experiment shows is the peptidoglycan cleaving enzymes are important for bacteria to grow. If they are not there, then they die. Right? So now this gives us now a tool to identify or to isolate new antibiotics, right? And next few, one or two slides, I'm going to just spend some time on telling you about antibiotics, right? You know that antibiotics either kill or inhibit the growth of bacteria, right? You remember that the penicillin identification was a really huge milestone for human health, right? And this is what now what you see here in this is a petri dish which contains a lot of bacteria, and now if you put some amount of antibiotic here, it inhibits the growth of the surrounding bacteria and you see this cleared zone, right? This is one other way people figure out the antibiotic activities or antibiotic assay. So you put in the center an antibiotic and it kills the bacteria which are present in this region. So this is a busy slide and has a lot of antibiotics listed. Don't want you to get into this. But at some point or the other of our lives, we would have taken most of these antibiotics, right? For any kind of fever, we go take antibiotics, right? So the beta-lactam antibiotics, in which penicillins belong to one class, these are very, very popular, right? We take them all the time. Then I'm sure many of you would have taken tetracyclines. So tetracycline is a molecule which inhibits protein synthesis in the cytosol, whereas all the beta lactams, as I said before, will not make the cell, will inhibit the cell wall, so they all kind of kill the cells. Some of them will not allow the other cell wall components to be made, right? So here there is something called rifamycin. Rifamycin is used whenever people get TB. Right? People use metronidazole whenever they have stomach upset. So all these things are very commonly used antibiotics. So we have several antibiotics, but then what is the need then to identify new antibiotics? That is now a major problem in antibiotic usage, because everybody is using excess antibiotics. Now, bacteria now has learned to live with those antibiotics. It is called antibiotic resistance. Maybe you would have heard about this. People call antimicrobial resistance. So the microbes are developing resistance to all these known antibiotics. So then what happens is, now, for example, if we have fever, we normally take penicillins. But if we are infected with a bacteria which is resistant to penicillin, then that bacteria is not going to be killed by penicillin, right? Then which means our fever is not going to subside, very simple. So we require now new antibiotics to be discovered. That is where people, now most of the antibiotic research and the bacterial research is going towards that direction. So, yeah, penicillin was identified around 1942. Between 1942 and around 80s, people have discovered major classes of antibiotics, tetracyclines, rifampicins, everything. But since then, the antibiotic discovery has come down a lot, right? So since 2000, only 4 of them, right, have been discovered. So which means that we are in dire need of identifying new antibiotics. And what we think, what our research tells us is, now we can essentially target these peptidoglycan hydrolases, which are identified in this study. If we can either isolate or synthesize small molecules, which will inhibit the activity of these enzymes, right? Then these bacteria will not be able to cleave the peptidoglycan, right? Hence, they will die, right? It's almost exactly like penicillin. Penicillins will inhibit the cell wall making enzymes, whereas the new molecules which we intend to identify will inhibit the cell wall hydrolysis. So this is where my research ends, and in next few years I want to study how the how we can identify these small molecules against these cell wall hydrolases. At this point of the time, I want to take a break and then ask you whether you have any questions, or, you know, did it make any sense to you? We can have a conversation now.
First of all, thank you, ma'am, for this wonderful presentation. Just, I got to remember the terms that I studied in my 10th and intermediate. Thank you, ma'am. And I have a few questions to ask.
Yes, please.
Yeah, I have a question. Yeah, this is Geeta.
Yes, Geeta.
Has the effect of fasting on bacterial growth been studied? Like when someone fasts, does that affect how bacteria grows and multiplies in the body?
Yeah, I actually, really good question. People haven't really studied about the fasting, but what people have looked is your diet plays a major role in your gut bacteria population, right? So, for example, if you eat very sugary foods, right, then the normally, if you think of your stomach is very acidic, right, and it doesn't harbor a lot of bacteria. But when you eat a lot of sugary foods, in the stomach itself, the bacteria start growing, which is actually bad. That's where it leads to ulcers and some kind of stomach acidity and all those things. So this has been studied pretty well. People are fed with different kinds of diet, and then they look at what kind of bacteria you have in your stomach, whether they're good ones or bad ones. So this kind of association has been made. But on fasting, I haven't come across any studies of fasting.
Thank you. So
I think all of you should remember, people always say that you are what you eat, right? And it is really true. People did not know for a long time what makes it. But if you just eat healthy, in 10 to 15 days time, your gut, it's called microbiome, okay? It's called the full microbes what you have in your gut, stomach, and intestine, and all that. So they all change. The non-vegetarians have a different kind of microbiome. Vegetarians have a different microbiome. Some of them, of course, do overlap, but many of them are quite different.
I do have another question, if no one else does. I think Danush has a question. He's following the rules. Go ahead, Danush.
Thank you so much, ma'am. This is Danush. The thing is, that I want to ask, is the studies only, the studies that carrying CCMB only related to the cells or things are generally
related to? I couldn't hear, it got broken, yeah.
The thing you have, this PPT says that the works much include only about the cell walls and related things, right, ma'am? Is the only studies the area and only cell walls or bacterial growth, or any, is there any extended part related to that?
Oh, okay. I am sorry. Yeah. So CCMB has something like 60 labs. I am one of them. Okay. So all the other groups study very different things. I am the only one who studies bacterial cell walls. So for example, there's one group which studies stem cells, right? You know how what stem cells are, maybe, I mean, they are cells which can differentiate into any things. Then there is a lab which actually studies how you can do ecology, right? Conservation biology of animals and plants. And somebody who actually looks at how the protein structures are deciphered, how do you examine protein structures. They're all very different. Some people work on antibodies, some people work on coronaviruses, some people work on influenza viruses, right? So there are all kinds of research which goes on bacteria, viruses, right? Human cells, mice, plants, rice, right? All kinds of research goes on in different labs. So I was only talking about my lab's work. My work, yeah.
Yeah, and the thing is, one more small question. Yes, did you ever get, did you ever get any overlapping or any work? Did you ever seen that work related on the something like you said ecology, bacteria? No, ma'am. So if that can be used something like to treat integrated ecosystem for killing of the harmful bacteria with the useful bacteria. So something like, did you ever get that work in our general life?
So yeah. Good question. I mean, in fact, that's the thing now people are trying to focus on. So the useful bacteria are the so-called probiotics. And very often, if you are given antibiotics, people also give you something called probiotic. I don't know how many of you have taken something called Sporlac. When you get diarrhea, you can actually just buy a sachet of Sporlac and then you eat it. Sporlac is, again, full of bacteria. Okay. There's like 1 billion bacterial cells in that sachet. And then we just eat that tablet or we, drink it with water and all that. So people think that this harmless bacteria now is going to populate in your stomach and then remove. It's not going to kill the bad bacteria, but it is going to outcompete the bad bacteria. Okay, so there's so much of this, so they will all compete for food and all that, so that the bad bacteria now will not be able to grow and then they would die. And these days the new therapy is eating these kinds of bacteria to as a therapy for a lot of autoimmune disorders, right? Or even some kind of stomach upsets. So if I have stomach upset, then I would actually eat somebody else's microbiome, some healthy person's microbiome, okay? So that I will get their microbiome into mine and then I am going to be okay. So this is becoming very popular and maybe I think after some time, this is going to be a new kind of therapy.
Yes, ma'am.
Did I answer, Tanush?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you so much. I will be asking at the end of the session because that is another related. Okay, thank you. As of this presentation, it's cleared my doubts, ma'am.
Okay. Okay. So, now it's like, most of my science is done. I thought I'll just take maybe something like 10 minutes of next 10 minutes in talking about my journey and the difficulties which I had in my life, what kind of decisions I had to take to do this journey. And some time ago, so a kind of comic has been made on my science journey. So I just thought I'm going to show this, okay, the comic which has been made by CCMB. So yeah, so you can see it here, how I have looked at the bacterial growth. And I little bit talked about this supervisor proteins, and the space makers are the cleavage proteins which, you know, help in breaking the walls, and then the supervisor actually supervises when these proteins work, right? Yeah, so wow. This is where my life starts, okay? So this is my older brother and my older sister and me. You know, we grew up in small places and we were not very well off. But because we grew up in smaller places, and you should imagine this is something like 50 years ago, there were a lot of trees and all that in villages, right? So that's where I little bit gotten into liking to be in, you know, in mostly like forest places, or kind of, I would call it little bit like a nature lover, right? That's where I did. And very typical of the parents, both my parents wanted all three of us to become medical doctors, okay? And whereas my brother and my older sister, they were actually became doctors, and now they're very successful eye surgeons. I actually didn't want to become a doctor, and I really, really had to oppose my parents, much to their frustration and anger. But I had to really sustain that. Of course, in the end, they had to give up because of various reasons, because maybe I was very stubborn. So finally, I ended up studying chemistry in BSc. Okay, so BSc, I mean, chemistry was my major subject, and then botany, zoology were my minor subjects. And I was really had good fortune to study in a very good college in Hyderabad, St. Francis College. That time was very famous and had extremely good teachers. And the chemistry teachers were so good that I still remember when I walked into chemistry lab in my BSc first year, I knew at that point of the time life that this is where I want to be. This is where my place is. Till that time, when I was doing my intermediate, I really had no clue what I wanted to do. I only knew I don't want to do medicine, but I didn't have, you know, I didn't know exactly what to do with my life. So that was a turning point in my life. I did pretty well in BSc. Then I have gotten into MSc. I wanted to do very specifically biochemistry, which where you integrate chemistry and biology. And I went to do MSc biochemistry in University of Hyderabad. So that is where in your audience is my good friend, Saraswati. I met her there, and then we are friends even now. So after doing MSc, I dreamt of doing PhD. Like, 2 years of my MSc, I only dreamt of doing PhD again in biochemistry, and in a very famous institute in India, which is in Bangalore. It is called Indian Institute of Science. Very well known. Okay. Set up by Jamshedji Tata in somewhere in 1800s. Even that time and even now, that is a top ranking institute in India. And I kind of, if Saraswati is hearing this, she knows how much I was passionate about. Okay, so, but, you know, things don't work out very well, right? So I gotten married when I was 20, as I was finishing MSc. Okay, so all the, all my dreams, almost I won't say shattered now, but yeah, that time I felt that my life is coming to an end. Okay. So, of course, I think I'm not going to go a lot deeper into that. So I had gotten married, and then after quite some time, after I got married, then I had, two children. Then I actually decided to do PhD again. I joined CCMB, and that is where I, so when I started doing PhD, I was something like, 32 years, right? And something like 10 years, I had to keep my plans under control. So then at 32, I started, and I had a very good PhD mentor. So he helped me in, learning, and then in all these, he trained me in microbiology and biochemistry and all that, right? So in fact, all my confidence which lost in that earlier things, it all came back. I became extremely passionate again, and then that is where I started almost my second innings. Then I finished PhD, okay? And this represents my difficulties. I had two small children. I had to do PhD. I had, everything, the housework, the lab work and all that. I won't say it was, really too difficult, but I should admit that several times I thought, oh, I am going to now, discontinue this. I cannot take this stress. But just persevering those hard times helped me. And that is where I was able to sustain my thing. So after finishing PhD, I went to US for 6 months training to do further work on, it's called postdoctoral research. Of course, I couldn't go for a long time leaving children and all that, but I went for 6 months here to, this is in Seattle, this place. And that is where I actually first time got exposed to how science operates in other countries, developed countries, and that helped me a lot. So this was such a good institute, and there were extremely good mentors, who are very friendly, and they're slightly unlike Indian counterparts. Both of them are equally good. They have their different ways of operating. So they're very friendly, and then they, they treat you like their friends. So this is where my mentor was, Dr. Jerry Smith. He, again, instilled confidence in me and then encouraged me. And then we, in fact, still talk to each other. You can imagine he's now 88 years, and then he still runs a lab, active lab, and then works every day. Okay, that's, again, that's how the passion for science and research goes. Of course, even in general, he became a good friend, and then he visited India, he stayed in my house, and we keep in touch now. I came back from US, and that is where I actually started doing the work which I have explained to you right now. All the while during this time, whenever I would look under microscope, this kind of thoughts would come to me. But that time I didn't have my independent lab to work on all these things. So in 2007, I got my own lab, and I was able to do what I wanted to look at. So this is where I have decided to work on these E. coli, and then understand this problem of how bacterial cell walls grow. So again, last 12 years, again, I had to put in a lot of hours and then effort. And again, same thing. Sometimes very elation of doing the science, sometimes the disappointments, but everything went by. And then now at this point of the time, our work is, work went very well. We were able to publish in international journals. So things are actually, looking better. I do have a lot more future plans to do. And this is exactly what I told you, during my work presentation, right? How a single bacterial cell will become longer with new peptidoglycan synthesis. And this is how you can actually design molecules which will inhibit these hydrolases. So, right, thereby you can actually make these bacterial cells die. And all this finally culminated in a very good look. Awards, people don't do science for getting awards or recognition. They do it because it's their passion, right? But however, when other people recognize, then it is something like a validation of their work, right? And that's, I'm fortunate to have that kind of validation. So this is came in the form of this Infosys Prize, which came 2 years ago. So I think I am quite fortunate to say this.
In the comment section, there are some questions. Why it is harmful to consume more antibiotics and are ampicillin and ampicillin antibiotics good for consumption?
Okay. You said, why is it harmful to consume more antibiotics, right? Yeah. One, actually, there are two reasons why it is harmful. One is, if you eat a lot of antibiotics, it's going to kill all the bacteria which is present in your gut, right? Both the harmful and the useful ones. That causes a lot of stomach problems, mostly the digestion problems, right? And your immune system comes down. All those things will happen if you consume a lot of antibiotics. Then the other thing is, because bacteria now see a lot of antibiotics, now they will start acquiring antimicrobial resistance. That is how the antimicrobial resistant bacteria have evolved. Okay, so now if these bacteria come up, then next time when we get infection, then it is these antibiotics are not going to work, right? So it is two things. So one, now most of the countries now are actually trying to control the antibiotic usage. Not only the countries, but both the doctors and all that now. Major problem is because we do get, the across the counter in medical shops, we do get antibiotics, right? People are, government is now trying to control that availability. So that they want to decrease the evolution of antimicrobial resistant microbes. And you also said ampicillin and amoxicillin. Is that what you said?
Yeah.
People always, lot of amoxicillin we do take for somebody gets toothache, for example, because penicillin derivatives work very well for anaerobic gram-positive bacteria, which normally cause these tooth infections. So we do take amoxicillin and ampicillin quite a lot. They are safe, okay. But of course, as I said, excess of them is not good. People actually, I don't know how many of you have taken amoxicillin, but if you take it, in many people, it causes severe diarrhea because it disrupts all the gut microbiome. Right, but of course it comes back after 2 or 3 days, then you are back to normal. So you always have to weigh the advantages and disadvantages, right? So if there is a need, we should take the antibiotics if there is a need. That's the
thank you, ma'am. Dhanush Sharma, go ahead.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you so much for the wonderful lecture. I mean, it's not a lecture, it's something like a story, because hurdles are everywhere and we have to cross them, that even the word they displayed is new. For a mindset which has the learning mindset, age is just a number that you have proven. Jigyasa, I can see the word jigyasa, which means curious to know, if I'm not wrong. And thank you so much for that, for the wonderful presentation. And the thing I want to ask is, did you met with any work that is something like integrated ecosystem, where the work has done on the integrated ecosystem? Something like what I want to say is there any bacteria, something like the water bodies which we are seeing now are mostly polluted, right? Is there any work done on the bacteria which helpful in cleaning the contaminated water? something like ecosystem or bacteria that is integrated, that develops the integrated ecosystem instead of using poisonous chemicals to treat the water or to treat the our biodiversity. Yeah, that I want to ask.
Yeah, so I have to give you some examples. True, you know about oil spills, right? Oil spills in the seas, right? They're very bad because huge oil containers come in the sea, and sometimes they do spill oil, and the whole sea becomes, you know, black with that oil. Very bad for the birds, fishes, and all that. So now people treat oil spills with bacteria, which eat off those oils, right? Oil is essentially the carbon molecules, right? So those carbon molecules can be nutrients, can be the food for some bacteria. So people have isolated such kind of bacteria, and then they use to clean up the oil spills. I know that I'm not answering you very directly, because when you say polluted waters, it may have lot of things, correct? So if it is a single pollutant, yes. For example, is it polluted with arsenic? Then there are bacteria which convert harmful arsenic into not a harmful arsenic compound, right? Because you know that they are +2, +3 arsenic things. So things like that are there. And people are trying to figure out, now identify plastic eating bacteria. This is going to change the world, right? Because now we are so worried about this plastic, the green environment. So, but still people have not come across these bacteria. This work, now what exactly you are asking is picking up. Now this is where the new microbiology research is, you know, is going towards in this direction. Can you use bacteria to decontaminate a lot of things, right? Frankly, including ourselves, right? Good bacteria now will make us feel better. So all these approaches are now coming up fast. And if you know the pollutant, then you can use the those bacteria. Another actually good example is soil has lot of nitrates and nitrites. So if you put different kinds of bacteria into the soil, right, then they will start releasing the nitrites and nitrates, and they'll convert it into nitrogen, which is useful for the plants. So all these kinds of things are actually now coming up, and then they're becoming popular.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Yeah, those are the related things I want. Because sustainability with the clean environment is the now needed for action. Yeah, is there. So I want to know, yeah, those things or the... Is there any way so that we can work on the things, right? So thank you so much.
Yeah, you are right. Sustainability is the thing, and then people are trying a lot to look. I see that some of you are working on textile engineering, right? People use a lot of chemicals in textile printing and all that, right? So you need to decrease all those chemical usage, right? And particularly if you look at leather industry, to cure the leather, people use a lot of chemicals, you know, very harmful chemicals. So now people have come up with different bacteria which actually dehair, right? They remove all that hair which is present on the skin, and they will smoothen. So there's an institute in Chennai called Central Leather Research Institute. Now they're doing very good research on bacteria now which clean up the leather. They just use, you know, that they get this all this cattle skin and then they treat this cattle skin with this bacteria, and then after a week or so they really become very nice and clean. So that's a very good example of keeping the environment safe and green. Yeah.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you so much.
So I thought I will just put one last slide, right? Because I knew you were all young, somewhere between 18 to 21, and just wanted to share what did I learn from my, you know, such a long journey. Sometimes a happy one, sometimes disappointed, right? I mean, several things happen to people, right? I mean, it's a mixture of things, right? And all of us finally want one thing, and this is what I always think, it's a pursuit of happiness, right? Everybody's, I think, goal is this, even if they are looking for money or a career or anything, in the end, they want happiness, right? How do you actually, look, this is not something like a lecture, but then these are my personal thoughts. So I felt that having a goal in life is quite important, right? If we don't have a goal, then it feels actually meaningless. We just while away the time. So, and if also if that goal is somewhat meant for public good, right, and not a really, really personal one, then it gives you a more satisfying feeling and a more fulfilling life. I think you all understand what I actually mean to say. Something like, say you want to acquire a great cell phone and that's your goal in life, right? It's not going to give you a lot of happiness. But if you do something for others, something larger, even if it's a smaller, you know, a deed and all that, it will give you the cell phone maybe, but it doesn't give you that, you know, that great satisfaction and that feeling of feel good in your feel good component. This is what I think happens. And if you have a goal, then how do you actually one achieves, right? Then what kind of tools and what kind of things you should have is, I think, in my opinion, two things are very important. This is passion to fulfill that goal, and you need to have discipline to make that happen, right? And also, of course, these two are more important. And particularly when we are young, we have a lot of energy, right? We become pretty intense, emotionally very intense. And sometimes that also leads to negativity, right? This something somehow hampers one's productivity and one's creativity. Everything, I mean, this is one huge emotion which actually can affect somebody's well-being, both mental and health-wise. So just, I think one should learn to forget, forgive. Really, really very important in life. This is may not be for your career, but just a general, advice. And then having a perspective on larger things in life, right? Societal problems, the problems of the world, and then thinking about them would actually lessen all the problems of which you face at a personal level, right? It's always something broader, not always concerned about oneself, right? That helps a lot. How do you actually get, again, having perspective on larger things? Reading would help a lot. I mean, I think, unfortunately, the digital things and the cell phones have come, which distract us every day. But again, one can make these things as tools for reading, right? Reading and then knowing things. It's actually much better that with these tools, one can improve their current understanding of the world and then, you know, knowing things and all that. It has become very useful. So one has to see how they actually exploit these, your gadgets, right? Let the gadgets don't, they shouldn't make you as, addictive, but you should make use of them to increase your own understanding. So also think that this, because all of you are young, I'm sure you're all physically active, but physical activity like sports, right, games and all that brings in a lot of change. One becomes very open, right? And their endorphins are released. Now people really think that physical activity even changes their, their microbiome, molecules in the brain. So the feel-good hormones are actually made more by physical activity. So all these things, I mean, now you are in an age where you can actually incorporate these things at the right time of your life, right? So that the, you know, you will essentially achieve what you want to achieve. Yeah, with this, I think I would like to end, and I really wish you all the very best. And if we have any questions, you know, in general about pursuit of happiness, I would be happy to answer.
First of all, thank you, ma'am. It's a really inspiring journey of your ma'am. Thank you so much for this wonderful presentation. Yeah. There is a question in the comment box. Is there any alternatives for antibiotics naturally?
Any alternatives to antibiotics? Yes. I'll stop sharing and then I'll...
Yeah.
Look, traditionally, antibiotics meant that antibiotics are made by live organisms, okay? Say something like, penicillins are, for example, are made by a fungus, right? So now people have small molecules, chemically synthesized small molecules as alternatives to antibiotics, okay? And then again, people use, as I said, right? People use probiotics as alternatives. People also now think that some kind of plant extracts and all that, right, serve as some kind of alternatives. But their real, you know, mechanism of action and all that is not very clearly understood. Okay, I mean, if I want to say something like, people now that this corona came, right, now everybody says people should eat pepper, eat cloves or ginger, stuff like that. Now, they all know that they have some kind of benefits, right? Medicinal benefits, but exactly what kind of benefits it has, what is their active ingredients and their mechanism of action, that is all known. That is again one more direction for research.
Thank you, ma'am. Please raise your hand if you have any questions or comments.
Can I ask?
This is, go ahead, Dhanush.
Okay, sir. I will ask you. I think the question is not framed. I will frame the question.
Okay. So, first of all, this is Shravan. Thank you, Dr. Manjula Reddy, for, being on the call and giving this fantastic talk. We usually have the talk only for about maximum of 90 minutes. So we are getting close to 90 minutes. Are you okay that the students ask you even now? Or are you?
Yeah. I don't mind. Yeah, absolutely. It's great.
Okay. I think that's why some of the students are feeling, little uncomfortable because the, So thank you very much. And it was definitely a wonderful talk. I was at CCMB. I actually visited my friend, used to work at CCMB when I was studying in chemical engineering at OUCT. This was in the 1986 to 90. So CCMB was this amazing facility at that time. It was so beautiful. It had air conditioning, which was really big at that time. I used to come there, and then they had a really good canteen too. So it was really good. So I used to come to visit my friend, and used to go to the canteen and everything. So thank you very much for that. So
and even now the canteen is good. You could come.
Okay, I'll do that next time when I visit India. So students, you know, if you have questions, please do ask.
Yes, ma'am. The last and final question from my side. Is there any bacteria that excrete waste as the water? Their waste as the water?
Look, there are these hydrogen metabolizing ones. The end product, I am only thinking of biochemical reactions, okay? So there the end product is water, okay? So if you really look for bacteria, you will find something which will actually make water from hydrogen and oxygen.
Yeah, Vivekta, go ahead.
Thank you, Madhu. Ma'am, I'm Vivekta, and thank you so much for giving us the talk. We really loved it. And like, we especially loved the your story part. It was in the cartoon thing. Like, we really loved it. That was so cute. So my question was, is there any possibility to produce hydrogen using microbes, especially using bacteria?
Yes. You just have to look for, and bacteria make it. They actually do all kinds of things. Particularly, there are a class of organisms called archaea, so which live in all these kind of very hostile environments. You know that they oxidize sulfur, they reduce sulfur, they do all kinds of things. So there are hydrogen making ones, there are nitrogen making ones, there are methane producers, right? I mean, there are all kinds of bacteria. In fact, I think I am the wrong person to ask, because I have not traditionally studied microbiology, but it's very easy to figure out that they are there.
I mean, ma'am, is that hydrogen, can we commercialize the hydrogen? If you have any idea.
The only problem is most of these things are not commercially viable, right? Because you just have to grow large amounts of bacteria, right, to do this. So that has actually hampered all these things, right? Look, you have to find ways of, you know what nitrogen fixing bacteria does, right?
Yeah.
So then what you do is you do this inter crop things, right?
Crop rotation.
Yeah. That's how you need to get into if you want to use these systems, right? Okay. Otherwise, it becomes very difficult to make hydrogen from these things. Making them chemically becomes a lot more easier.
Okay.
You remember I was talking of rifamycin?
Okay. Yeah.
So rifamycin was identified from a bacteria, and it makes, that's how first 10 to 15 years people were making rifampicin. They were growing large cultures of this bacteria, then purifying this antibiotic and then making. But now, many chemical laboratories now started making rifamycin in a synthetic manner. Okay, so they start with these basic compounds and then make in large containers. That has become much cheaper now.
Okay.
So people, tend to use whatever is cheaper, right? Because that's what helps. Yeah.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Shivani Akka, go ahead.
Hello, ma'am. I'm Shivani. Thank you so much for giving such a wonderful talk. The way you have explained about the bio, all the things you have researched on, and your life journey, as Vivekta said, was very wonderful, creative. Did you make those pictures, ma'am, or?
No, I didn't make the pictures. So we in CCMB, we have a science communication person. So somebody called Disha. So she and they made this.
Wow.
If you had seen that last slide, then it was actually written, acknowledge their names, right? But looks like this is the recent in thing. People actually do, I had only given them 3 or 4 pictures of mine, photographs, and then that's how they have made it. So that's the new art form these days. Okay. I even do see in my phone that there's a very easy way of making those things.
Yes,
you could even use some programs, I think.
Yeah. And also the way you have shared your story on how you started, difficult or how you have overcome all the things. And I'm sure that your children and your parents might be very proud of you. Your accomplishments. I have a silly or
ask anything. Okay, I'm totally yes, okay. Yeah.
Yeah. By any chance, is there any research or something where our state of mind enhances the growth of microbes, or by being happy? Does it affect the growth and the improvement or something, ma'am?
Yeah. People now, I mean, earlier they, I think, didn't have evidence. People believe, but they did not have evidence. Now there's a lot of evidence coming in this direction. So if you are happy, you make different neurochemicals in your brain. If you are sad or unhappy or angry, a different set of chemicals come, right? Remember, all this is just the electric connections between two neurons, right? Whatever we feel is chemically that. And when you make that connection, the synapse between neurons, different chemicals are released, right? People call it as glutamate, there are different chemicals which are made, right? So people, of course, there is no, I think, not direct connection has been shown between those chemical formation and your gut microbiome. But what people say is your what you eat would reflect your immunity, right? And also your general health. And then there's a lot of connection now people are making between particularly diseases like Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, autism, and depression, between food and these neuropsychiatric disorders. Okay. So I just think eating healthy, right, makes a lot of difference. But what you are asking is something the vice versa you are asking, right? I think on that there is not much information now, but the other way there's a lot of information. Yes.
Ma'am, if I want to start a research on something like this, what should I do, ma'am?
If you want to look at what's your course? Are you doing BTech Chemical Engineering?
Yes, ma'am, Chemical Engineering.
Okay, so this is a very good starting point for doing research, whatever you actually want to do. Do you want to go into chemical sciences, biological research? Now, after BTech, these options were not there. But after BTech, people can go into research, because 4 years of college is enough for doing PhD. Many people, for example, in CCMB, right? After BTech, one can join for PhD, provided they have a fellowship. Okay, so you have definitely the eligibility to go into research. Okay, But that depends. Do you want to do PhD in India or in Europe or in US? Then you have to take a different path. You have to do different exam, fellowship exams, and those things. I would be happy to talk to you. You will find my email ID in CCMB website. Then in case if you are interested, then you could actually write to me.
Hello, Dr. Manchala Garu. Shivani is, we call her the gratitude goddess. She's the one who spreads gratitude in our team. She keeps on talking about, she is the one who, she is really helping us to be more grateful. So that's why she's asking this question. Are these bacteria, the probiotics or the positive bacteria, the good bacteria, will they increase or will they grow more if there is a more grateful attitude or grateful, if you're more grateful? I think that's the question, right, Shivani? Yeah.
You think so?
Yes.
Like
the state of mind.
I don't know the answer, Ma. I don't know the answer, but one can actually find out. If you, for example, identify people who are happy or you're unhappy or negative, and then look at their gut microbiome, right? And then see differences, right? One can at least say that there are differences between the happy and unhappy individuals. It's a very, your question can be converted into an experiment. Okay, and of course, that's what all research is about, right? You initially have a question or hypothesis, and then you make it into an experiment, and it is a possible experiment. Maybe you could do that.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. I will reach out to you. Thank you.
I have a question, if I may, Dr. Reddy, on behalf of all the young women here. I speak for women. We face challenges. We have family, we have children to balance, and you went through 10 years, you said, of struggle. And you may answer this without going into personal details. What is your advice to these young women where they can maybe not lose those 10 years? Those 10 years are also very valuable. And also manage their family. It can't always be family or this, right? We have choices to make, but do we always have to make that choice? Either family or my profession or my passion. What would your advice be to these young women?
The extremely difficult question is what I really think, because everyone talks about priorities and your own passions, but it's not easy making the decision. Your family is very important, right? I mean, for example, of course, you're all quite young. Maybe you're not still thinking of, settling down and children and all that. But this is a practical problem. Most of, grow to become 25 or 30, then you're all thinking of a family and then settling down at the same time about your career. And that's where Geeta's question becomes extremely important, right? But this is the time, what I only say is, this is the time you don't give up on things, right? You can slow down your things. For example, you have a young kid at home, your kid requires you, right? You cannot escape that the responsibility and the affection, and it's a biological thing, right? And I really think, look, we are not born here to do research. This is all an artificial societal thing which we have started doing from last 100 years. We also should remember, right? At the beginning, we're all animals, okay? So animals with some kind of intellect. So the animal instinct has to be satisfied, and also the intellectual, there's a need, right? Intellectual need also needs to be satisfied. So you have to have both, right? But some people have intense need for this biological things. That is where people give up on, you know, they have to make choices. But many of us want to do both, right? We want to have a reasonably good family, happy family. At the same time, we want our careers to flourish, correct? So this is where then you have to frankly work harder. There's no other choice at all, right? Take a lot of family support. So Geeta, just this one. So I keep telling all my PhD students are something like around 30. They all ask, what do we do? And I had, some of them actually live. So this is where I said, don't, you have to depend on your family, at least right now in India, right? You still have your mothers and mother-in-laws not working a lot, right? I mean, some of them are, but some of them are not. So you should make use of them. So I just keep saying, don't fight with your mother-in-laws, okay? And keep that thing open, and then you look at a bigger thing in your life rather than a smaller thing, right? So that's how you kind of get going. I mean, all of us have to come up with our own plans and strategies to come out of this. I mean, I am sure Geeta would agree. All these problems are there between something like 25 to 40, right? Once the kids grow up, then, for example, me, I mean, my children are completely grown now. I can stay in the lab till 9 o'clock. I have no problems. I'm just thoroughly enjoying my work now. So all of us will be in that place at one point or the other. So you should just have patience. Things don't work out, don't give up. Take it slow. Take one step at a day, and then deal with things. And even if in some situations you have to give up, that's not the end of life, right? There are always options, other options, whatever option you want to take.
Very well said. Thank you.
Yeah. Sangeeta, do you have any other question?
Good evening, ma'am. Ma'am, you made our evening great, ma'am, with your presence. Thank you so much, ma'am, for the brief explanation of bacteria and bacterial cell walls. Actually, many of us don't know much about this, but with your presentation and explanation, we got to know brief and clear about them. Thank you so much, ma'am. Ma'am, your journey was really inspirational, and your passion and dedication are so adorable, ma'am. Thanks a lot, ma'am, for spending your time with us and clearing all our doubts very clearly and with so much of patience. Thank you, ma'am. Yes, ma'am, as you said, when we make our distractions as our resources to achieve our goals, that is where we really get success and satisfaction as well as. Thank you so much, ma'am. Ma'am, actually, I didn't had any question because all my questions are cleared. Thank you so much, ma'am. Just I want to confess my thanks to you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Very nice of you, ma'am. Very nice of you. And you so nicely summarized, and you're able to, very nicely get into the whole crux of whatever I have said. I think you need to develop good writing and then good thinking. This one, you should do that. Yeah.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Definitely, ma'am. Thank you for your suggestion too, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Yeah.
Dr. Manjula Garu, we just Sangeeta just got a mentor. His name is Mani Racharla. He is so we have mentors for pretty much every student. Oh. So Sangeeta just became part of our TOP ESL family. So she is one of our rising stars. She is very willing to. She wants to learn. We have our platform was created by these young people. and we believe in expression, not impression, you know, not trying to impress, but to express. So the rules are, we have very few rules. The rules are respect yourself and respect the other person. See beauty in yourself and see beauty in others. See greatness in yourself, see greatness in others. And then we have two rules saying, do not criticize a person or criticize an idea. So that's it. Everything else is open in this platform. And so we have been doing this for 4 years now, and the students have done quite a bit. One of these days we'll try to reach out to you and tell you what we have done. Many of the students, we have published over 12 books right now. The students by themselves have done it. So we are also now, the students are working on presentation skills. The students are learning English. They have English classes on Sundays. All of this is, they are all creating by themselves. So we see, Sangeeta just joined. So probably within a year, you will see a massive change in her. And Dhanush and all of the students, when they first joined, they wouldn't even open their mouth. Now Dhanush is actually trying to, we started a program called Top University. We want to have our own university where we can create the education system. We want to have a individualized, a customized education system. And Dhanush is driving that initiative. So a lot of amazing things these young people are doing. And I think you'll be very excited when we'll present to you sometime. Thank you very much.
Yeah, it was really amazing. And you were all, you and Geeta's effort, of course, is amazing too. I mean, you know, the very commendable to sustain this, this interest, and then you need to spend time, right? I mean, that's where it comes down. So I think the kids are lucky. Yeah.
We are lucky too.
Yeah. I think everybody, I mean, it's always, that ecosystem has to be a kind of, as you said, be polite and respect each other, and then that kind of ecosystem works. There's no other ecosystem which will work.
Yeah, the ecosystem always has to be win-win for everyone, and a learning atmosphere. Everyone should be in a learning mode in that ecosystem, then everyone will benefit. So we concentrate a lot on not teaching, but learning. So these are simple words which we have started doing it, and that has made a huge difference. So thank you very much, Madhu. Do you want to do the final thoughts?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Now let me present a gratitude card by Top Gratitude Team. Thank you, Dr. Manjula Reddy, ma'am. We express our deep sense of gratitude for accepting our invitation and giving us a Top Talk. We learned many amazing things from you. It's been a great honor. Thank you so much for being so patient and answering all our questions. Once again, thank you so much for sparing your valuable time with us, ma'am. By Top Gratitude Team.
Very nice. I'm really, I'm very happy and then moved by this gesture. Okay.
Yeah.